Let's start our discussion. Okay, it's only 60 students till now. Let us have some general discussion based on whatever you already have studied in your machine design one. Okay, well, if you are designing a component, you select a material, and if the material properties, depending upon whether it is ductile or brittle, you know the ultimate strength of the material, or you know the yield strength of the material. So how do you design? What is your design criteria? What is the allowable strength of the material that you assume from these two values, whichever is given. We have to use some service factor, and this service factor takes into account the variation in the load, the service conditions, or that makes it the design load for which you are designing a component, or the design power for which you are designing the component. So, do you know how do you take the allowable strength? Anyone? Anyone can tell me this? Sai Pranav. Rule number two, Sai Pranav. Upon factor of safety. Again, what is the value of that factor of safety? Okay, so let me tell you, if you have either the ultimate strength given or the yield strength given, then the allowable stress, if none of the factors are given or the factor of safety is not given, then we normally take the ultimate strength, which is multiplied by 0.18 times. So we are reducing it almost by we are using only 18% of it. So 82% is a reduction. Similarly, if the yield strength is given, we normally go with only 0.3 times of its yield strength. This is the allowable strength that should be taken as per the ASME code. This you'll find in the design data book also. So next class onwards, I am expecting all of you to have design data book and a design data book by B.D. Shivalkar. For this topic, gear design, will be referring to B.D. Shivalkar design data book. So there is an ASME code, and then when we select the material, depending upon its usage or its application, we'll be using the SAE codes. So, if you are selecting SAE 1030, what does this SAE stands for? Rule number four, Manish. Manish, are you there? Hello. Ambika, Anish, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Society of Automotive Engineers, correct. So SAE stands for Society of Automotive Engineers. And what do you understand by this 1030? The first two digits, it is signifying the kind of material. So it could be normally if it is 10, this 10 stands for plain carbon steel. If say this is 1330, then this first two digit 1313 will indicate this is manganese. If it is 31, this will indicate this is nickel chrome. If it is 40, it is carbon molybdenum. So the first two digits are indicating what is the material. And what is the indication or what is the significance of last two digit? Is indicating it is 0.3% carbon. It is 30 out of 100. That is the percentage of carbon in this material. If we are talking about manganese and it's an alloy, it is talking about the percentage of manganese in that particular alloy, which is the important or the significant component. So this is how it is designated, or this is how we interpret what is SA1030 and what is SA1040. So if you have to pick up between two grade of material, SA1030 and SA1040, this is the Society of Automotive Engineers. 10 stands for plain carbon steel. If it is 30, it has 0.3% carbon. If it is 40, it is 0.4% carbon. Okay, one more concept which I wanted to discuss the other day. Suppose the value of yield strength for carbon steel is given as 330 MPa. And so the maximum allowable strength that we are assuming is 0.3 times of this 330, which comes out to be how much? 99 MPa. Okay. Now you're working with some design, say a shaft design, and after calculations, you end up with getting the diameter as 30.3 mm. And as per the data book, the available diameters are 30 and 35. Which one do you select? If by calculation your diameter is coming out to be 30.3 and the available diameters are 30 and 35, which one would you select? 30? Why would you go for 30 mm? Aditya?
Because ma'am, if it is less, then there is no issue. If it is higher than that, then there may be a problem in allowable strength.
You increase the diameter, you increase the cross section, and the stress would reduce for the same load, right? So if you are reducing it to 30, which means the cross section is reduces, and if the cross section reduces, the stresses would be more. If you increase the cross section, then the stress would go down. For the same load, stress is inversely proportional to cross section. Ame, why 35? Ame? We can machine it. Are you going to reduce the diameter from 35 to 30.3 mm? Yes. which would be pretty costly and affair, you know. Anybody has any other logic to justify for 30.3 mm, the available diameters are 30 and 35, which one we are going to pick up? Okay, so as a thumb rule, by and large, anybody would suggest if you are getting greater than 30, you should go for 35. Even if it is 30.1 or even if it is 34, you should go for 35. But we have to check for what are the stress induced. If we go with diameter as 30.3 exactly, you will end up with the stress value as 90. If you are selecting diameter as 30, you will end up with stress value, say by calculation, 93. And if you are going for diameter as 35, the stress value will be quite small, say 80 or 75. So you increase the diameter and the stress induced reduces, and this stress is quite safe, pretty much safe as compared to the maximum allowable strength. But look here, the maximum allowable strength is 99. We have used very high factor of safety. Actually, the yield strength is 330. We are only using 99 MPa. So with selecting a diameter exactly 30.3, the stress induced would be 90 MPa. If you slightly reduce it, the stress would increase, but this is still safe. This is still less than the maximum allowable strength. Whereas if you go for the higher one, this value of sigma, the stress is much less. It is although very safe, but the weight of the shaft increases, the cost of this would increase, and if you are going to machine this, then that machining cost or the finishing cost further increases. So there is always a compromise between what would be the cost and what is the strength. So our first criteria is safety, and we have to ensure that this value should not exceed 99. If with diameter 30 mm, if this value becomes 100 or 101, then you cannot go with diameter 30 and you have to go for the higher diameter. So this is how conceptually we'll be selecting the diameters or selecting the material. Is that clear? Amir?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we were discussing about pressure angle. In the last class, I asked you to tell me what should be the pressure angle and why 20 degree is used as a standard pressure angle. Anybody wants to answer this? Anyone, please? No? Sarvesh? Sarvesh? To decrease wear, okay. Sarvesh, are you still sleeping? Jaswant? Okay, let me tell you how it helps in decreasing the wear. Let us start with why earlier it was 14.5. Earlier is some 30-40 years back, the pressure angle was always selected as 14.5 degrees. Now if you have really studied, yeah, to avoid undercutting, that is correct. Why 14.5? Why not 14? Why not 15? Even 15 degree would have reduced undercutting. So how did they arrive at this term 14.5? Better lubrication. It's not about lubrication. Yes, it is about the proper meshing, but not about the lubrication. So why 14.5? In the lathe machine, which is used for years together now, there is a component called lead screw. And this lead screw is a long threaded screw, which will have a nut which can move in the forward direction or in the backward direction. So this lead screw is essentially converting the rotary motion to the translatory motion. This lead screw is continuously rotating and this nut will move forward or backward. And with this concept, on the lathe machine, the part which needs to be machined or placed, this moves along with this nut. So lead screw is used for years together in all such kind of machines. Now, this lead screw is using a thread which is known as Acme thread. Have you studied this in your machine drawing? Acme thread? Yes, no? Ambika?
No, ma'am, I don't recall it.
Okay. So an Acme thread will have a thread structure like this, where this angle is 29 degrees, or half of this angle is 14.5 degrees. And this 14.5 degrees, this pressure angle comes out from this Acme thread. And now in the gears, when we are talking about, if we draw a common tangent and if there's a line of action, this angle is the pressure angle. And same thing happens when we talk about a gear tooth. So the same angle would be repeated here if this is the gear tooth. And somewhere here at the junction of face and the flank, if I draw a vertical line, this angle is also 14.5. Although we don't define pressure angle as the angle between the vertical face and the face of the tooth, but by trigonometry, this is pressure angle and this also comes out to be 14.5. So it is from the Acme thread, which was popularly used in lead screw, that the pressure angle was taken as 14.5. Another possible reason why this angle was 14.5 is yesterday we were discussing about designing the gear tooth. And here there is this load FP, which has a horizontal component responsible for transmission of power. And then there is this radial component FR, which is undesirable component, which is trying to reduce the distance between the shaft. Or its reaction offered by the shaft will try to separate the two gears. And this angle is phi, pressure angle. What would be the sine component of this? If FP is, say, 1 Newton, what would be the FR component if angle theta, angle phi is 14.5? Check it would be 1/4 of this. So sine 14.5 comes out to be almost 0.25. Please check. Yes. So it is only 1/4 of the force which is this undesirable component acting on the radial direction, whereas its cos component is sufficiently large. It is almost 0.95 or 0.94. So this is another reason why 14.5 was adopted. So we are trying to reduce this undesirable component FR. Then it was also observed that for this kind of shape with 14.5 degrees, the undercutting was more. Now, what is undercutting? Undercutting is, now this is meshing with another gear. Undercutting is because of this curvature, this part of the gear tooth, which is the face, this will try to dig out material from the flank region here due to continuous meshing. So these angles and these curvatures for 14.5 degree pressure angle is such that this undercutting is huge. So with 14.5 degrees, there is more undercutting. And if the angle phi is increased to 20 degrees, the shape of this would change and this undercutting reduces. So undercutting is a kind of wear. So every time it is meshing and if it is used for n number of cycles, the wear increases because this undercutting increases. So with 20 degree, the tooth becomes broader here at the base, wear resistance is better, undercutting is less, and the tooth is also stronger. So if we happen to compare pressure angle 14.5 versus 20 degree, this one is stronger by its geometry because this angle the face makes with the vertical plane is larger. This is a broader tooth. This will have less undercutting. Who is roll number 44? And this can also use less number of teeth. Who is roll number 44?
Yes, ma'am.
Why are you joining now?
No, ma'am, I have joined earlier, but my name.
Then
I rejoined.
you left the meeting in between.
Yes, sir, ma'am.
Okay. In your theory of machines, have you discussed about what should be the minimum number of teeth on a gear to avoid interference? Saurabh?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so with pressure angle 20 degrees, what is the minimum number of teeth that must be there?
But formula, I don't remember.
Okay, now the value. If both the gears are of same size, if their radii are same, and if the pressure angle is 20 degree, then the minimum number of teeth should that a gear with pressure angle 20 degrees should have is 13. You cannot have less than 13 number of teeth, otherwise there would be an interference. But with pressure angle 14.5 degrees, this value is sufficiently high. So here the minimum would go around 23 or 26, depending upon the other parameters. So with 20 degree, you can have less number of teeth on the gear. What is the benefit here? Benefit is manufacturing becomes easier. A small gear with whatever dimension, when we are trying to cut gear teeth on it, cutting less number of teeth would be always easier. So this is about the pressure angle. So yesterday we were discussing about design of gear. And we design based on where it's going to fail. So we assume that, or this is how the assumption goes for the Lewis equation for bending, that a gear tooth is assumed like a cantilever beam of length L. And so we have taken this height of the tooth as L. Its cross section is B and H. So this is B here perpendicular to this load, and this is H along the load. And for this beam of uniform strength subjected to bending, the bending stress induced by the formula we obtained was 6FBL by BH square. And if we are multiplying this term after rearranging in terms of FB equal to something, we are multiplying and dividing by module. So H square by 6LM, this term is known as the Lewis form factor. And the value of Lewis form factor for different pressure angle, because this pressure angle will govern what is the geometry. This will entirely depend upon the number of teeth. Module is also a ratio of diameter and number of teeth. So we'll refer the design data book and we'll pick up the value of Y. If we know the number of teeth, you know what is the Lewis form factor. And FB, this is the bending force and the bending stress. The same equation is rewritten as the beam strength and the allowable strength of the material. Once we select the material, this value S0 is again given in the design data book. We have to calculate FB, and FB will be taken always greater than or equal to FT, where FT is the force, the component of the power transmitting force, which is responsible for rotation of the gear. So we'll continue from this step where FB is greater than or equal to FT. Now you have to keep in mind that any rotating component will always have some dynamic loads acting on it. So this FT is the static load responsible for transmission of power or transmission of torque. And there is a component FD, which is the dynamic load. Dynamic load is the load which is continuously varying with time. And as per Buckingham's equation, this FD is given by FT plus FI, where FT is the static load and FI is the incremental load. This is given by Buckingham, and we have a long expression for FI. It is a part of his research, so we are not going to derive that. And this equation is given in the design data book. This is giving you the equation for Fi, where Fi is the incremental load, the load which is continuously changing. It's changing its magnitude and its direction. So this is represented like, I hope you are taking the notes with me. This is the variation with time, and this is the force. So if this is zero, then there is a constant value FT. This is FT, which is the static load, which remains the same. And then there is an incremental load, so load which is continuously varying. This is FI, incremental load. And so by this expression, the value of FD, which is this value now, what should I write FD as instead of FT plus FI? What should be this FD now? This should actually be FT plus minus FI. The incremental load is changing. So here the dynamic load is less than FT, and here it is more than FD, and again less than FT and more than FT. So ideally this FD is FT plus minus FI. But since we have to design it for the worst condition, we always go with this formula, FT plus FI. There is no point in designing for FT minus FI. So if it is safe for FT plus FI, this load, it has to be safe for FT minus FI. Now tell me, what would be the reason for this incremental load? Yes. We already have discussed this. Rishikesh? Rishikesh, you are there?
Yes, ma'am. Hello?
This is Rishikesh, room 40. Yeah, tell me. What would be the reason for this incremental force?
Actually, I don't know.
This is something we have already discussed. Rishikesh, rule number 57. Rishikesh, rule number 57. What might be the reason for this FI? Yes, no. Tell me if you don't know the answer. Pratyusha? Pratyusha, 59. Where do students disappear in between? Well, we are discussing such an important topic. Pratyusha? Okay, Pratyusha is absent.
Yes, ma'am.
We discussed what is FI in the earlier class. You remember what is FI?
No, ma'am.
What is the reason behind this FI?
No, ma'am, I don't remember.
Kaustubh?
I'm sorry, ma'am, I don't remember.
You have to note down whatever we are discussing in the class, because I keep asking you. Otherwise, I don't know how many of you are actually attending this lecture. So the dynamic forces, they are coming because of various reasons. One is the inaccuracy in teeth spacing. That is the spacing between the adjacent tooth. So there's a chance that, yes, inaccuracy in the tooth profile, inaccuracy in the teeth spacing. So spacing between teeth number 1 and 2 is some X. Between 2 and 3, it could be little more than this X. So this could be X plus delta X. Between 3 and 4 could be X minus delta X. So with this little inaccuracy in the teeth spacing, this leads to this FI, the incremental load. This also happens because of inaccuracy in the tooth profile. So somewhere it is not exactly an involute. One of the tooth might end up with a shape little different from involute. Or this could be because of the deflection, some deformation in the gear tooth. Because of high load, the tooth is already deflected. These are some of the possible reasons why there is a dynamic load coming into the picture. And once we have decided that the strength of the gear tooth is FB, what about this FD? What should be the relation between the dynamic load coming on the tooth and the strength of the beam? Which one should be greater than other one? Which one should be greater to avoid failure? FB. So FB should be always greater than FD. And FB is FT plus FI. And if you remember, in the last discussion, we said FT should be less than FB. So we initially start our design based on FP and FT, because FT value is known to us. FI you will get to know after you get the module and the face width. FTIN will know from the power, the rated power or the designed power upon VP. This will be FT. From FT we'll calculate FB, and later once we are done with selecting the module and the face width, then we'll get the formula for FI. So initially we don't know FI, and all we know is FB should be greater than FT, or it should be equal to or greater than. So we are now modifying the Lewis equation, and instead of writing FB as, now this is an important concept, same thing we'll be using in helical gear design, worm and worm wheel design. So please listen carefully. We are modifying the Lewis form factor by multiplying it with the factor CV. And this CV is taking care of this unknown incremental load FI, modified Lewis equation. So what we do here is we reduce the value of FB by multiplying it with CV, and CV would be a number always less than 1, such that this FB reduces by 40% or 50% or 60%, and this CV will depend upon, there is a formula for CV depending upon the RPM, which would be 4.5 upon 4.5 plus VP, or 3 upon 3 plus VP, or 6 upon 6 plus VP. But initially, when module is not known, when the value of VP will be not known to us, and so we'll be using and we'll be assuming CV as 0.4 if the RPM with which gear is rotating is less than 1000 RPM. Now, this is not given in the data book. This you will have to remember. We'll assume CV as 0.3 if the gear is rotating with an RPM greater than 1000, less than 2000. And we'll be using this CV as even less, 0.25. If the RPM is greater than 2000. I'm explaining again. If your gear is rotating at say 1500 RPM, you are using the CV value as 0.3, which means beam strength is only 30% of the actual beam strength. So you're already reducing the beam strength to take into account this unknown FI component, which is not known initially. While we are designing the gear, all we know that it has to transmit a power of say 45 kilowatt when the gear is rotating at 1500 RPM. That's all. So diameter is not known, number of teeth is not given. So you don't know what is the linear velocity. So this value is also not known. So while designing, we'll assume some number of teeth, we'll calculate what is the module, we'll calculate the face width, then we get the value of beam strength. Whereas the actual beam strength should be calculated in terms of the dynamic load. So I know this is slightly difficult, but once we start solving the numerical, this part will be more clear. But as of now, you have to just understand why we are using this term CV. The CV is known as the velocity factor. We are using this term CV because initially this FI, the incremental load component or the dynamic load, is unknown. So we intentionally reduce this beam strength by say 60% or 70% or 75%. So whatever is the actual value, we are taking only 30% of that value. So that once we calculate FD, even this condition will hold true. This FD will be less than FB. So we'll initially calculate with multiplying it with CV. We'll get the value of FB, we'll equate it with FT, We'll find out what is the module. We'll find out what is the face width. Once we get that, then we'll check for what is the value of FD. And now from the design data book, anybody now is carrying a design data book by Shivalkar by any chance? Aditya? Saurabh? A soft copy is not available. You need to have the hard copy of design data book. If somebody is having the the hard copy, please take photographs and share with your friends. FI will depend upon various factors, and this FI is 21 times VP. This is an expression which was derived by Buckingham. C into E into B plus FT. So once you know FT, you can calculate FI. Without knowing FT, you cannot get FD. Upon 21 times VP plus root over C E B plus FT. Now this C, value of C is again available in the data book, and this will be based on what are the two gear materials that are meshing together. E is the error. So there are two graphs. One is permissible error and another is probable error. So once you have the design data book, I'll tell you how to read the design data book. And then there is this term B, which is the face width, which will again calculate based on what is the module. FT you know, VP again, N in RPM is known to us. Once we get the module and number of teeth, we'll find out what is the diameter, and from diameter and N we'll get the value of VP, which means all these parameters are unknown when we start the design. So we are designing only based on FT, and from FT we'll get FI and then we get FD. That is the reason we are introducing this velocity factor CV to reduce the beam strength, so that under dynamic load condition also this is quite safe. So we'll be assuming, as I said, after this calculation we'll get some value of M, we'll get some value of B, and we will then find out what is FD. And if our FD value is safe, if it is less than or equal to FD, then we proceed with the design assuming this module and face width is correct. And if this is not true, we increase the module or we increase the face width. This is how we design it for bending, assuming this is safe in bending. So in this particular equation, as I said, E is the error in manufacturing which causes the dynamic load. C is known as deformation factor. This value is also given in the design data book. This deformation factor, this depends upon the surface quality. B is the face width, as I said, VP is the peripheral velocity. So if you remember, we design it either for bending or for wear. So if at all it fails, it's going to fail for bending or for wear. And to check for wear, there is a simple expression again directly given in the design data book. We calculate what is the wear strength. Wear strength It depends upon the material, it depends upon the manufacturing. And this wear strength is at pitch circle diameter D into the face width B into another constant K, which depends upon the manufacturing, the type of material, hardness, and a size factor Q. As I said, D is the pitch circle diameter, the one that we have calculated from the module and number of teeth. B is the face width of the gear tooth. K is a constant or a parameter which depends upon the hardness. Again, this data is given in the design data book. Material or the manufacturing technique. Without design data book, we are not going to start next lecture. So all of you must join in this link with the design data book. If you don't have design data book, you better stay at home and take rest. Q is a size factor, which depends upon number of teeth on gear and pinion. What is TP and what is TG? Number of teeth on gear and pinion. TG and TP or T1 and T2. So this will help us to get the value of FW. Once you get FW, we again compare this FW with what? The wear strength and the dynamic load. Which one should be greater? For it to be safe under wear, which one should be greater? The dynamic load FD or the wear strength FW? Ayush? FW, the wear strength, if this is greater than the dynamic load coming on it, your gear tooth is safe. If this is less than FD, then what do we do? Suppose while designing, we come out with the value of FW, which is less than FD. What do we do? Ayush? Yes. The dynamic load is whatever load is coming on the gear tooth, but we can definitely increase its wear strength. So we can change the material to increase its hardness, or we change the module. With the change in module, its diameter can be increased, or the value of B face width will try to increase. So by increasing one of the parameters, which is redesigning, we'll try to increase its wear strength so that it is safe under dynamic load. So as I said, without design data book, we are unable to start our design. So while we start our design, we have number of variables, a number of parameters to assume. The first thing is we'll be selecting the pressure angle. What pressure angle you will normally select, Ayush? Ayush?
14 to 20.
14 to 20. Aditya, what pressure angle you will normally select? Rushika, what pressure angle you will normally select?
20.
20. So this is the standard pressure angle that we are using these days, as I said. But if some constraints are given, then we can go with some modification. So normally the pressure angle that we'll be selecting in 99% of cases is 20 degree full depth. Now what is full depth? There is another gear tooth profile which is 20 degree stub. So what is the difference between stub and full depth? If this is the gear tooth, this is the full depth gear tooth. If there is a space constraint, then this much height is reduced. So this part is cut and removed, and this remaining gear tooth is known as a stub tooth. So 20 degree, the pressure angle remains the same, but this addendum height is reduced, and that makes it stub. And this is only for low space application. So if the problem specifically mentions, or if the designer wants to manufacture or design a gear pair in a limited space, so if the space is a constraint, then we go for 20 degree stub tooth. And if there is no space constraint, if the hardness is sufficiently high, there is no issue of undercutting or wear, and if there is a requirement of low noise, then and only then we go for 14.5 degree pressure angle, full depth. This is for low noise, no space constraint, nothing to worry about undercutting or the wear. So hardness is sufficiently high. Similarly, when we have a complete range of, we never use 25 degrees, Aditya. We never use 25 degrees pressure angle. As you go on increasing the pressure angle, the FT component, because this is FP coming on the gear tooth, this is a desirable component and this is the undesirable component FR. You increase the value of phi and the desirable component FT will go on reducing and undesirable component FR will go on increasing. That was precisely the reason why initially 14.5 was increased, was used, because this component, desirable component, is more. But because of undercutting, because of high wear, and also the ease of working with a round figure like 20 degree instead of 14.5 degrees, essentially for wear and undercutting, this has been increased to 20 degrees. Further, if you increase the pressure angle beyond 20 degree, FR component, undesirable component, increases. So we never go for a pressure angle greater than 20 degrees. Is that clear? Then the face width B. We have to select module, and the face width value is always less than 12.5 times module, and it is greater than 8.5 times of module. Once we select the module, we check what is the value of B coming out to be, and if B is in this range, then we say it is safe. If it is not, then we reduce the value of M, or we redesign, we change some parameters, say number of teeth or pressure angle, so that B always lies in this range. So the minimum value of B is 8.5 M. This value should not go below this. The value of VP, as you know, is pi D N. And this will depend upon number of teeth that we have selected. Now there is another table of how many number of teeth we are going to select. So normally for pressure angle, of 20 degrees, the minimum number of teeth must be 13. It should not go below that. But for good balance, we will always try to select a number of teeth around 25. And there are criteria given depending upon the conditions mentioned by the vendor or the designer. When can you have number of teeth as 18 or 19 or 14 or 15? But 25 degree is giving you a good balance. So if there is nothing mentioned, it's always safer to go with number of teeth as 25 on pinium. So our design will be more or less standardized with such data. So only and only if it is mentioned that wear is not a criteria and low noise is an important criteria, only then we go with 14.5 full depth. If low space is, or the space is a constraint, only then we go with 20 degree stub. Else we'll blindly go with 20 degree full depth pressure angle. So tomorrow I'm repeating, we are going to design this gear and all of you must have either the soft copy or the hard copy of design data book by B.D. Shivalkar. I'll start the lecture with how to read the design data book, how to extract the information, and then we'll solve this problem. Otherwise, this won't be clear. So if you are sitting in the class without design data book, you will not be getting a single a line or an expression how we are getting that, why we are selecting, what we are selecting. So try to get it from your seniors or the soft copy of it. As in when required, I can post the images from the table, but that will not be sufficient because I want you to turn the pages to check with various tables and why this table, why not other table. Okay, any doubts? Or whatever discussed today or till today? Pradyumna, any doubt? Rishikesh? Rakesh?
No, ma'am, no doubt.
Prabhat, on number 79. Prabhat, are you there? No doubts. Clear, okay. So I'll be asking you why, what is the significance of this CV. And if you don't give me the answer tomorrow, then I'll know whether there were doubts or not, whether it was clear or not. Whatever we are discussing today, I'll be asking you the same questions randomly to any of the students. Well, thank you. We'll stop here.